Good evening. I'm here to talk to you about the most important thing on the planet. No, it's not the internet. It's not the automobile. It's not even the computer. It's water. The source of life on Earth. The force that has given rise to cities and civilizations. The sign that life may yet exist on Mars. Water makes it all possible. Yet, we pollute it. We squander it. We take it for granted. Our cavalier approach to water would be cause for concern in even the best of times. But right now, it's downright alarming. Climate change is transforming our relationship with water by intensifying two cycles that have challenged humans for millennia: drought and flood. Never before have we faced a threat on this scale. Yet never before have we had so many solutions at hand. And it's those solutions that give me hope. And it all starts with understanding the value of water. I've worked on water issues for almost 20 years now, but my most profound appreciation for it came on a trip to Zimbabwe when I was a young lawyer. I was walking to Victoria Falls, which is the largest waterfall on Earth by some measure, and I walked by children on the streets begging for change and collecting putrid water in the streets from the gutters. And when I walked by with a bottle of water in my hand, something shocking happened. The children literally dumped the change out of their cups and begged me for clean water. And yet here we were, less than a mile from an enormous source of fresh water. Yet the children didn't have access to any of it because of poor government policies and a lack of infrastructure. And that's when I came to appreciate what life might be like without clean water. So where does our water come from? I mean, here in the US, basically, you turn on the tap and out comes plentiful water whenever you need it. It's a modern miracle, really, because most of that water really comes from a nearby stream, a river, or a lake, or an underground aquifer. And it's transported into your home thanks to a local water agency, or through a pipe and a pump, or through a well. It's an incredible convenience for us. But do we really know how much water we use every day? How much of this life-sustaining substance we use? The World Health Organization believes that a person needs 5 gallons of water a day to meet basic food preparation and hygiene needs. 5 gallons a day. I use more than that, a lot more than that. The average American uses about 100 gallons a day. And yet, my monthly water bill is less than my monthly cell phone bill or my monthly cable bill. And I don't even have HBO. And yet, are these things the same value in terms of my life? Are they the same in terms of my ability to survive? Sure, it might sometimes feel like you can't go without your cell phone for a few days, but you literally cannot live without water for more than a few days. In California, where I live, we're experiencing the worst drought in 1,200 years. And scientists tell us that with climate change, drought in California will become more frequent and more intense. Meanwhile, the increasing temperature from climate change will cause the water we do have to evaporate much faster. A double whammy, if you will, that will force us to do more with less. The good news is we can. We know how. So where do we start? First, we have to prioritize where water goes based on where we need it the most. In our communities for drinking water, in our farms for food, and on our rivers for healthy fisheries and wildlife. This is the San Joaquin River in California, California's second largest river, a river with no water. It looks like this for some 60 miles. Funny thing is, fish need water. So do wildlife. Unfortunately, they don't have it right now. Nearby, though, in all seriousness, on the Sacramento River, where they do have some water in the river, last year water temperatures were so hot that 95% of the winter-run juvenile Chinook salmon died because the water was too warm for them to live. So what do we do, though, when we face the opposite challenge from drought? Flooding, where we have too much water. Heavy storms are very common here in the Midwest. This past summer, here in Indiana, researchers estimate that crop losses will exceed $500 million because of flooding. With climate change, these heavy rains will become even heavier and more frequent, leading to more flooding, more risk of landslides and water pollution. So we need to address these problems, and a lot of the solutions can start right at home. In California, half of the urban water use is for outdoor irrigation, basically for green lawns. So we can be reminded of a bucolic English lifestyle while living in a semi-arid Mediterranean climate. Getting rid of our green lawns and replacing them with native and drought-tolerant landscaping could do enormous things for urban water supply in Southern California. We can also make smart choices as consumers. Things we do in our home, things we buy, things like faucets and toilets and showerheads, and appliances like clothes washers. Modern front-loading clothes washers use a third of the water that the old-fashioned top-loading washers use. They also save you money, and they save energy. And they reduce carbon pollution by 700 pounds of CO2 a year. That's like taking a vacation from driving for nearly 1 month out of every year. In Australia, dual-flush toilets have been used for decades. There's one button, one flush for liquid waste. There's another more robust flush for solid waste. And yet, we don't see that very often here in the United States. But good policies can make a big difference. In Los Angeles, they've spent a lot of time and energy encouraging folks to be water efficient. And now Los Angeles uses the same amount of water today as it did 45 years ago, yet has added 1 million new people to the city. Let's think about agriculture. This is an almond. I brought one today, too. One almond takes 1 gallon of water to make. And almonds have gotten a bad rap in the California drought. Are they really the biggest water hogs, though? Well, my colleague Dana Gunders has a new book out, and she's analyzed a whole bunch of foods, crops. It turns out beef, 1 pound of beef takes 1,850 gallons of water. Now, what does that mean? Well, Dana has converted it for us into your daily shower, something we can all relate to. And we're told we should conserve on our showers, take shorter showers. 1 pound of beef is the equivalent of a 6-hour shower, assuming you have an inefficient shower head. If you have a very efficient shower head, it's actually a 12-hour shower. Think about that. Just leave the water on all day when you go to work. Now, this isn't to judge people. I eat meat. It's to put things into perspective so we can make informed decisions in our lives. And in case you're curious, a pound of chocolate takes the same amount of water as that pound of beef. But who in their right mind would ever eat a pound of chocolate? Seriously. And for those of you who enjoy beer, the good news is a beer is the equivalent of a 4-minute shower, which is less than milk and orange juice. So all you college seniors can feel really good about putting beer on your cereal. Fortunately, there's a lot we can do in agriculture to improve the situation. In California, about half the cropland is irrigated through flood irrigation. Basically, they just flood the fields like they used to in ancient Mesopotamia. We still do that. Drip irrigation, though, invented in Israel in the 1950s, targets the water so that much less water is lost through evaporation. You can double crop yields while reducing water use by 40% or more. Enormous opportunities there. There are other things we can do in our communities as well for smarter water use through reuse, basically recycling wastewater and reusing it through water reclamation for industrial purposes, for agricultural uses, and for drinking water. Yes, even drinking water from recycled water. The largest water recycling facility in the world is in Orange County, California, where they recycle 70 million gallons of water a day, enough to supply the needs of 500,000 people. And if times get really tough, desalination can convert seawater into drinking water. Right now, it's very energy intensive, it's very expensive, and there are serious environmental consequences. But with improvements in technology, this could be a viable source of new water for many coastal communities around the world. Now, in terms of flooding and our cities, what else can we be doing? Many of our cities have just been paved over, and it doesn't allow water to infiltrate. It just runs off. But if instead we replace concrete with green infrastructure, with things like green roofs and rain gardens, we could allow and capture the water and allow it to infiltrate into our groundwater aquifers. We can also reduce urban flooding by reducing the volume and velocity of runoff. Philadelphia, for example, has committed itself to greening one-third of its paved surfaces in the coming decades. This is what Philadelphia would look like with green roofs and rain gardens. What kind of city would you prefer to live in? We also need to protect ourselves from flooding and sea level rise. We need to make sure that our infrastructure is designed to withstand aggressive flooding. Things like our roads, our power plants, our sewage treatment plants, our airports, our hospitals. Simple things like moving things like generators and boilers to the second floor, like they've now done after Superstorm Sandy in many parts of the East Coast. And also just moving out of the way. And what about our homes? Are they safe? In Monmouth, New Jersey now, they're required to build 4 feet above the 100-year flood level as a result of Superstorm Sandy. Unfortunately, though, many of the flood maps have not been updated to reflect the risks of climate change. Updating those maps will be an important step to moving us forward and protecting our communities. Collectively, all of these steps are changing our relationship with water. Water can be a blessing or a curse. It can be a sprinkling or a downpour. We must respect water. That's what will make our communities strong. And it's not just about us. All life depends on water, like this whale I shared a moment with in Baja, Mexico, where its mother literally lifted it up so that I could pet it. Water connects us. It brings us together. The earth is our home. It's the only one we've ever known. Some people will look at this image and they will see continents. Some will see clouds. I look at it and I see water, the most important thing on earth. I hope you'll join me in protecting it. Thank you.